so super excited tonight to have Lorna Kelly here. She's going to be sharing some of her spiritual journey with all of us.
First of all, I want to thank the committee of the team, and especially Gigi, for inviting me here. A lot of work has gone into pulling this evening together. But one of the things I will say, since this is a nest of Catholics here, that when I first met Mother on that first trip, she asked me, "Are you Catholic?" And because my name is Lorna Kelly, I'm sure she thought you're Catholic. So I said, "Well, I was born Catholic, but I don't know how I feel about the virgin birth. I don't understand devotion to the Sacred Heart of Jesus, and I'm not at all keen on the Pope." And she went, "Oh, you're Catholic." And actually, ever since that time, I thought, you know, why am I being so nitty-picky about this? It doesn't mean to say that I haven't explored all sorts of other things. As Mother Teresa said, I love all religions, but I'm in love with my own. I felt that I had came down the assembly line of heaven, and as I passed by God, God stamped me, boom, alcoholic. And he said, "This time you're going to look for me. This time you're going to seek me." I went into this Catholic bookstore in New York. It was on 74th Street. It was called the Paraclete. It's no longer there. And in a very loud voice, I swirled around and I said, "Do you have any books in here about Jesus?" I had no idea. Really, I was so out to lunch. I was in the art field, and I don't know what I thought all the paintings were, and all the cathedrals were, and all the hymns were. It was all about Jesus, but it passed me by. And I think that's the most one of the most wonderful elements about having a relationship with this man, is that for every individual that has that relationship, it feels like it's unique and singularly theirs. You know, having a love affair with Jesus was not the sort of thing one could talk about at Sotheby's. It didn't go well. But my secretary knew that I had this fascination. And one Christmas, in Christmas of 81, she gave me a book entitled Something Beautiful for God. And it was by an Englishman called Malcolm Muggeridge, and it was about this woman called Mother Teresa. And then I had heard about her. Anyway, so off I fly to Calcutta, and I didn't dare write and tell those nuns that I was coming, because I knew they needed an auctioneer in Calcutta like I always did. I arrived at this mother house. I arrived there. Standing outside the door, and there's a chain outside the door, and there's a notice up that says "Mother in, Mother out," and there's something that slides across, and it says "Mother out." But anyway, I pulled the chain, and I could hear it ringing on the other side of this wall and this door, and suddenly the door is open, and in front of me standing a woman about my age, actually, and she's dressed in the Missionary of Charity habit, the white sari, and it's got little darns all over it where she's prepared it. It's the cheapest cotton sari. And she has a cross fixed with a safety pin dangling from here that's holding part of this sari together. And then she's got the cincture around her waist, you know, robe around the waist, and a large rosary hanging over that, and this crucifix like a gun shoved in the side of the chair. And I'm standing there, I've just just come in from Madison Avenue. I just walked in from Solvers. I have my hair expensively cut. I have, they don't make it anymore. I have Revlon's Cadillac Red on my nails and my toes. And I have my makeup properly done. And I have culottes on because I was going to Egypt. You know, khaki culottes. And I got this lovely little tailored shirt. And I looked at her, and she looked at me, and I said, "Well, hello." I said, "I'm here to help the poor." Selling billions of dollars worth of art a year, and I've got no idea. So she said, "Won't you come in? Do come in." And I realized in later I could see that she knew who the poor was when she saw the poor. "Do come in." So that was the beginning. And Mother Teresa was, I'm going to skip way on. Mother Teresa was not there at that moment. She was away doing something. But she was expected back in a few days. But they thought I was there to work. I wasn't. I was just there to see. And give my blessings to the poor. But they told me to stay below for Y. I went to this Y, and I don't think this Y. Oh, it looked like when the British left in 47 and the mattress had never been changed. And it was so dirty, and, but I, what could I do? I was given some grey sheets to put on the bed, and there were things living in the mattress with me. And I just had to have a shut my eyes and do it. A few days later, after I got there, I arrived one morning, and Mother Teresa was right there. I was sitting here, and Mother Teresa was right opposite me, here on the other side of the aisle. And it took me, I was there a while before I realized that this old lady sitting right opposite me was indeed Mother Teresa. So I met her after Mass, and there were a few of us there, and I shook hands, and she was very gracious, she was very tiny. "How are you? How do you do? Where do you come from?" All that. Very polite. And I felt, oh, I've met, this is Mother Teresa. This is the book. This is who I've been reading about. This was the woman who told me. This is her. So one afternoon, I'm standing in the courtyard waiting to go up to the chapel, and Mother comes in with some of her sisters. And as she passes me, I said, "Hello, Mother." And she must have had a tough day or something. Or she was very irritated. And she whipped around and she looked at me. And without looking me in the eyes, she went for my hand and grabbed my hand and pointed at my nails and said, "Why do you wear that stuff?" You know, it was obviously a aggressive question. It wasn't going to be followed with, "Why do you wear that stuff? I think it's so pretty." And I shot back defensively, "Well, I wear it because I think it's decorative." And she said, "You should decorate your heart. Besides, nail polish is expensive, and you should sell what you have and give the money to the poor." Well, suddenly I'm worried, my back is up, and my immediate reaction is defense. And I mustered myself up, and I thought, how dare this midget done up in a tell me how to dress, what to do with my money, who does she think she is, and I'm famous too. And I shot back at her. Well, I seem to remember that selling one's cosmetics and giving the money to the poor is exactly what Judas suggested to Jesus.
Yeah.
I'm sure all of you have had the experience of something coming out of your mouth and instantly wishing you could reel back the film. And as soon as it was out of my mouth, it was so rude. And everyone stood stock still around Mother, all the sisters. I mean, they were just, and Mother and I were like gunfighters down high school at high noon. And I'm all prideful and defensive. And she's looking at me rather shocked. I mean, and I felt, oh, I've done it. You know, what am I doing here? I don't belong here. I don't fit in. It's obvious I don't fit in. And now I've been groomed to this woman the world considers a saint in her own house. And I've compared myself to Jesus and her to Jesus. It doesn't get much worse. And then Mother did this. She did the thing that separates the ordinary from the extraordinary. Mother reached out to me and she said, "Who are you?" She said, "Where do you come from?" And she started to laugh. And I was so relieved at her laughing. You know, that she, Isaac chuckled, sort of, to get over my embarrassment. But she said to me, "Who are you with?" She said, "You always come by yourself. And we've never had anyone come quite so early for Mass. And I have to put someone out for you to make sure they answer the door that early in the morning for you." And we started talking. And I don't know whether it was just a connection. And the following morning, I was there for Mass, and she took me aside and was asking me more questions. I think she was intrigued that I had come all by myself. She was fascinated by the fact that I was sober. She was fascinated by the fact that I was in recovery. Mother had success with every form of suffering human, but she could not help the addict. And she could not help them because she did not have the words of everlasting life. She did not know how to say, "I know how you feel. Let me tell you what happened to me." So she was always so intrigued, and every time we got together, which was twice a day, she always cornered me and would start talking about something else, and then she'd always bring it around to recovery. And she talked to me so much about it that sometimes I'd say to her, "You sure you don't have a problem?" And one time I was in the house of the dying, and this young girl was brought in, and she was really at death's door. She was very, she was maybe 17, 18, I don't know how, maybe a lot younger. And she was absolutely filthy, and she had, her ears were split where her earrings had been ripped out. And she'd obviously been very used on the streets. And the sister in charge said, she just fell to me. She said to me, "Cut her hair off." And you know Indian women have this long, long hair, but it's matted and it's filthy. And I said to sister, "Oh, do I have to cut it? Can I not wash it or comb it out?" And she said, "No." She wasn't cruel, it was just face would become festive. She was covered in lice. So I had this young girl against my chest, falling against my chest. I sat on the cot and she was falling against my chest, and I held her hair with scissors. I just cut it as close to her scalp as I could. And she was powerless to stop me. She could not do anything. And here I was, this privileged Westerner with everything. You know, I have an apartment in New York and living in it, and spare set of shoes and some clean clothes and underwear and food in the fridge. And she, nothing. and the only thing she had was this hair, and I was taking it from her. And as those filthy locks fell into my lap, I could feel my heart kind of breaking and realizing that this young girl was me, and I was her, and it was, you know, Jesus in the distressing disguise of the poor. I came back to New York, I came back to my job. I could not get the experience out of my mind. So to cut a long story short, a year to the day, exactly, I walked back into that mother house in Calcutta, and Mother Teresa was there, and she looked at me and she said, "I knew you'd be back."